The year 2025 marks not only the middle of the 2020s as a decade, but the beginning of a whole new generation of people. That's right, from 2025, we will welcome Generation Beta into the world. Although people of this generation haven't been born yet, we can predict some things about them based on the current context that we assume will surround them and their life as they grow up. And that's what we are discussing today. So joining me to introduce this new generation is McCrindle's founder and principal, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Great to be chatting with you.
Okay, first of all, before we define Gen Beta, do you say beta or beta? I feel like in every presentation I almost say both. Even in an introduction, I was like questioning myself. How should we pronounce it?
I say beta. Okay. Most people, I think with that Greek alphabet, go for beta.
Okay, excellent. That gives me confidence moving forward. What years define Gen Beta and who will they be the children of?
Generations now define 15 years of births inclusive, and so Generation Beta are those born from 2025 through to 2039. So they're the children of Generation Z, or for the American listeners, Generation Z, but we'll stick with the King's English here. So a generation of parents is two generations from them, a generation being 15 years, average parents being 30 years when starting families. So the Zs aren't the children of the Alphas, but the Betas, and the Alphas won't be the children of the Betas, but Alpha, Beta, Gamma. And then the Gen Betas will be the children of Generation Delta. So it just sort of goes in alternate frames like that. And so, yeah, the children of the 20 and indeed soon to be 30 somethings of today, Generation Z, will be Generation Beta.
Yeah, it's a bit of a mind boggle when you think Gen Z are going to be the parents. Like in today already, the oldest Gen Zs, if they're having kids in their 20s or a bit younger than the average, which is kind of pushed into the 30s, they are the parents, like the next generation of parents, even though some of them, the youngest of that generation, are still kind of older teens. So it's interesting as we look at the beginning or on the cusp of a whole new generation. It's interesting, yeah, to think about who that generation of parents will be. In terms of the projections, I know that we have looked at population projections, you know, here in Australia and across the world. And based on that, we say Generation Alpha will be the largest generation based on fertility rates. How does the projected timeline for Generation Beta's birth and growth compare to other generational cohorts, Alpha included?
Well, that's right, Ash. As you said, Generation Alpha in Australia were the largest generation ever. Just as they were about to be born, the annual births here locally hit the 300,000 mark for the first time in a year, and it's maintained that for 15 years. But not only has the birth rate been dropping, the birth numbers have now been dropping as well. And so in the span of Generation Beta, there'll probably be some years where it goes below that 300,000. So this is just remarkable to consider for a moment that even though the population is significantly larger now than it was when Generation Alpha began being born in 2010, back then we had a population that had just hit 22 million. When Gen Beta begin being born, will be more like 28 million. So the population is more than a quarter larger now than then, and yet the annual births are around the same, maybe even in some years slightly less. This is remarkable, and the only reason for that is that even though the total population has been growing, the birth rate has been shrinking at the same rate. So yeah, we've got a quarter more women in Australia now than we had when Gen Alpha began being born, but the birth rate is about a quarter less than what it was then. When the Gen Alphas began being born 2010, we had a birth rate just below replacement rate. So if a couple produces two children, they've replaced themselves. No need for immigration. The population will continue on without that, just through natural increase. So we had a birth rate of 1.95, so just below replacement. Today, we're down to 1.6 births per woman, so well below replacement, and might even get to the 1.5 over the next few years as the Gen Betas begin. So in other words, from a a replacement rate phenomena to a very low birth rate of today. That's been the span over the last decade or so, and therefore the beaters will be certainly relative to the population, quite a small generation, and highlighting just that the alphas were the peak of the birth numbers in Australia. And that trend will probably continue globally as well. We probably won't see a generation as large as Generation Alpha in the future, Generation Beta just on the leeward side of those large global births.
That's interesting. It leads well into another question I have for you, Mark, which I'm sure many people who have listened to the podcast faithfully, who know anything about McCrindle, are pretty aware that we, and by we I mean you, are credited with giving Generation Alpha their label, choosing that label for this cohort of children who were born between 2010 and 2024. And that comes from the Greek alphabet. And I'd love for you to, I guess, briefly explain maybe to new listeners to the podcast how you came to choose that name, because now it's, if it continues this way, as it seems like it definitely will, we move to the Greek, we go to beta. But it's interesting, I mean, we always need to talk about why we name them that, because some people, I think, assume that we chose alpha, or that you chose alpha because they're a dominant generation, and even though they will dominate in terms of births, that's not why we chose that. So Mark, could you just elaborate a little bit, I guess, on how you came to name alpha, and therefore I guess that Greek alphabet, which is in turn kind of naming Gen Beta as well?
Well, generational labels, where they existed, came about because of a phenomena. And really the first were the baby boomers, and that's because they were part of this post-World War II baby boom. But after the baby boomers, we had an emerging generation in the early 90s without a label. And Douglas Copeland, Canadian writer actually, said, look, call us X. You know, we're not like the boomers. We defy a label. And that became the label, Generation X. And then we had Generation Y and Generation Z just naturally flowing from that. But as we've arrived at the end of the alphabet, and as that was approaching, actually, in the early 2000s, we had a look. I was writing a book on the generations and thought, well, you know, we don't want to go back to A, even though we surveyed people and said, what do you think the generation after Z should be called? And A was a common one, or the dot-com kids, or the iGen, the screen ages, all these sorts of labels emerge. But again, that's part of the problem. Labeling a generation based on what is current at the moment. We need something that can create meaning over time, that's more of a blank label, more of a scientific approach. So that's when I put forward the Greek naming approach, Generation Alpha, because this is the first generation born from 2010 on, so fully born in the 21st century in this new era of technology, a global generation with rising life expectancy, big numbers of births as well. And that label is stuck, and that then leads us to the next letter, Generation Beta, and then Generation Gamma, and Generation Delta, and Generation Epsilon as well. And if that approach sticks, I think it's helpful because it firstly allows people to understand the sequential nature of it. They can work out what the next generation is based on what the next letter is. When we were in the pandemic, you know, each new strain of virus was given, you know, Omicron or Epsilon or whatever. And that's what is used in science often in nomenclature, is Greek alphabet labeling. And it allows it to create its own meaning rather than have a meaning put upon it from the outside. And it also reminds us of the scientific nature of the behavioral science of generations. And if we have set spans of birth time, 15 years, and more scientific labeling, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, then it allows more of a sociological approach to generational analysis, comparisons, insights. It moves it from the pop culture frame to something that helps us understand populations in the future. So yeah, that's why we went with Generation Alpha and therefore Beta, and also the spans of time as well.
Yeah, it's interesting that different approach, the sociological approach, as you've mentioned there, to naming generations and generational analysis compared to defining generations around specific events. And it's interesting, I guess we had the baby boomers and we had X, Y, Z, but sometimes the Ys get called millennials, which is more of that descriptive label, which I know we've talked a little bit about as well. And it's vague in terms of, are we talking about people born in the new millennium, transformed in the new millennium? What connotations does that kind of carry? So like you said, I guess that's the benefit, right, of the sociological approach. It allows, it's a bit more, well, as you said, scientific, defined in some ways, but then also less associated with stereotypes. Is that, I think, a summary of the benefit?
Exactly. And it taps into that famous quote from Abraham Lincoln, who said, "What's more important than the name you're given is the name you make for yourself." And I think it's great for us to introduce this labeling approach, but really allow the generation to make a name for themselves. And Generation Alpha will come to have more intricate, embedded, complex meaning over time as we understand what the alphas are, who they are. And Generation Beta, in their own way, will create meaning over time. And that meaning will adapt and shape as they move through the life stages. And they'll carry the label with them as they move through, you know, their lives ahead and shape things and are shaped. And the label will grow with them.
Yeah, it's really interesting, generation analysis, how it comes about. And I think a lot of people are curious about the future, about even what Gen Alpha will be like. We have written a lot and spoken a lot on this podcast about them. And like you said, they're making a name for themselves. The older they get, the more influence they have. But with Gen Beta, I think people are like, okay, well, so what are they going to be like? And I'm already being asked about that, and I'm sure you are as well. So, Mark, what do you have to say to people when they do ask about who will Gen Beta be? What will they be like? What characteristics or values will they have? And what's the kind of societal context and trends that you think is helpful for us to understand in order to understand, you know, this whole new generation who are about to begin being born very, very soon?
Well, it's important to understand where they fit in this context, because generations do tend to be in some ways a reaction to the generation that went before. They're shaped by the one that went two generations before, because that's their parents' generation. And if we think, therefore, about the alphas that have gone just before the betas, you know, Gen Alpha, this massive global growth in births, this global connection, technology coming around and growing with them, even into this world of AI. And as we said, this first generation shaped in this digital global era, at a whole new level. I think the Gen Alphas coming of age in an aging population will have great opportunity to step up into leadership and shape things. And so maybe in a lot of ways they will be true to that label of Alpha. And coming after them is Generation Beta, in this era where we're seeing these birth rates fall, particularly in the West, quite precipitously, and indeed in the developing world as well, a significant slowdown. As we've said, Generation Alpha will be peak births globally. Generation Beta will see, for the first time in human history, births stabilize and indeed globally start to fall. And so with that comes a sense that, you know, population growth is not continuing. You know, there is a settlement of that. They'll be coming of age in quite an aging time as well. When the Gen Alphas began being born in 2010, the median age, the point at which half the population is older and half is younger in Australia, was 36.9. As the Gen Betas begin being born, it'll be 38.9. It's 2 years older. And that's significant in the span of a generation, to have that rise in mid-age, and indeed through their lifetime, their early life, the midpoint in population age will be pushing into the 40s. So an aging population, a shrinking one in terms of natural increase in births, one where their parents were shaped in more demure and contracting economic times. You know, the era that shaped their parents' Generation Z was the GFC. And suddenly a generation at the youngest age recognized that economies go up, but they also go down, and contraction and uncertainty and declines in property prices is a real thing. And that continued through the economic volatility of the decade or so after that, and then into the COVID pandemic, and that as the time that the Gen Zs were, the parents of the beaters were really starting their careers, was quite a time of challenge. So that's all to say that the experience of their parents will shape the future. And so Generation Beater will be shaped by parents who, in a lot of ways, live through economic and social challenge. And that creates a resilience, a grit, an ability to respond to uncertain times, but a conservative outlook, a desire to save, a desire to reuse, a focus on not just growth and ever more accumulation, but banking for a nest egg for uncertain times and thinking sustainably, economically, and indeed environmentally. And I think that will be quite the parenting input for these children. Indeed, probably the Gen Alphas who grew up with technology in their hands from the youngest age will see even a pushback to that, with Gen Beta having much more of a delayed exposure to technology, because I think parents have recognised the inherent challenges in technology, not just the upside of it. All of that to say that I think we will see conservative parenting amidst ongoing uncertain times, and a generation shaped like the great generations in the past were in war years or depression years, to be a generation that are resilient, adaptive, and prepared to respond to uncertain times.
It's really positive, I think, to hear that from you, Mark, in terms of there is a lot of doom and gloom out there about the future. And so to hear, notwithstanding that this generation, you know, we're not saying they won't face challenges, every generation does, but to have a data-led, evidence-based kind of positive outlook is, I think, quite refreshing, I'm sure, for many listeners. And as we've acknowledged, every generation, every decade holds its challenges and opportunities. Do you foresee any particular, I guess, societal, economic, technological, whatever the mega trend is, demographic, as you've mentioned already, what challenges and opportunities do you think Gen Beta may face as they come of age in the 21st century?
Well, technology is the monolithic issue that shapes particularly young people, but in such a rapid way transforms society, you know, all areas, how we learn, how we work, how we travel, how we interact and communicate and connect, how we're entertained. It just flows through all those areas. And so I think the future of tech is going to be key for Generation Beta. And what will that be like over these next few years? Because really, in half a decade, they're going to be the youngsters being influenced in those very early, you know, toddler years. I think it's the era of AI. I think that will be the dominant issue. If the alphas were shaped in the era of screens, you know, smartphones, devices, if Generation Z that went before was shaped in the era of social media and that connectivity on those new platforms, for the beaters, it'll be AI. As they see not only the machines start to shape our lives more, in some ways start to dominate more. I mean, keep in mind, from a generative AI perspective, we're only a year or so into the experience, and already rarely an article is written or an email delivered that doesn't have at least the opportunity of AI shaping that. And so think of what 15 years will bring if a year and a half has brought, you know, a lot of saturation and ubiquity of the use of AI. So it will be content creation and automation and the integration seamlessly of technology and generative content into their world. And I think that will be transformative. And our approach as a society, and indeed the parents of beaters, in how they use that and where they restrict that, and what the human interface should be, in what should be the domain of humans, and what we will allow the technology to creep in and shape. I think that'll be big. I think the demographic challenges will be big, as around the world we see large Western nations hit what Japan has already hit, contraction from natural increase, rapid aging of the population and responding to that through technology and productivity and also through migration. And I think the global nature of things will continue. So as we've seen in the last decade, issues in one part of the world, instability affects prices here, or the geopolitics there create local responses, and conflict out there leads to sometimes local conflict or protest over here. I think we'll continue to see that. Now, you know, it's really come at a rapid stage, this global connection through migration and media awareness and flows of information, but I think that'll continue to accelerate to be more seamless in terms of the global connection of issues for good and ill, and that'll be the lot of Generation Beta as well. But I think good opportunities for them economically. You know, they'll come into their learning and earning stages right at the time that the aging and the mass retirements are really starting to hit in the next two decades here in Australia. They'll see big wealth redistributions from an intergenerational perspective. Some will benefit from that, but I think it'll provide a lot of opportunities for them amidst property availability and job availability as well. So, you know, some good benefits to come amidst some certainly great uncertainties that the next two decades will bring.
Yeah, wow, it's amazing. Thank you, Mark, for painting that picture. And from a few different, as we said, megatrend perspectives, I was thinking as you were talking about AI and Gen Beta and how, like, in what school, for example, will look like in 5 years when those oldest Gen Betas enter in, what kind of devices will they be learning on or platforms? It kind of helps, I think, to give that tangible, what will the future look like? And I know we've got a slide in our presentations where we kind of question whether this generation will ever use a landline phone or, you know, a traditional GPS system, or if they'll need wallets in the future if everything's contactless. And it's interesting when you really think about how they'll live and what devices they'll use and what life will be like for them when they're, you know, 5, 10, like I said, in 15 years, when they reach that kind of teenage life stage, what life will be like. So, always fascinating.
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think there's you know, good encouragement in all of this. I mean, even around technology and the future of jobs, you know, people were thinking that as AI ushered in a year or so ago, I saw many lists that were saying, you know, lawyers are going to be the first group to go because, you know, AI can deliver all of that legal knowledge. And teachers and trainers, they're going to go because we can access learning anywhere, anytime. We don't need people standing in front of a class. Well, you know, here we are 18 months in and we've realized how wrong that was. Lawyers are needed more than ever because while you can access legal knowledge, a lawyer is someone who takes that content, distills it down, and applies it in a personal context or in an individual context. They understand the nuance. They can connect with the particular concept, and they make decisions. They've got that discernment to apply. And the same with a teacher. So I think that just highlights that it's the people skills. It's the decision-making skills, it's the discernment, the distillation of content to apply that to particular people and needs, to bridge diversity, to communicate effectively with human beings. Technology, AI, does not do that well. So my advice for Generation Beta and their parents for the future is double down on the people skills, understand the diversity, be a good communicator, develop leadership skills, be good at learning how to make decisions and how to distill content and choose what is most key and apply that, because that is not done well by technology, even generative AI. Anything that's just about information, sure, let the computers do it, but anything that's about the human interface, we're going to need people in that space. So, you know, for anyone who develops those people skills, the future is going to be bright.
A great reminder for us all, Mark. Thank you so much for introducing Gen Beta to us, to the podcast. We look forward to many more episodes, I'm sure, gleaning from your wisdom about generational insights, including Gen Beta.
Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.